We are back in the Epistle to the Romans, and we are nearing the end of our study, as you can see, because we're in Romans 15 this morning, and we're going to look at verses 1 through 13. Romans 15. Now we who are strong ought to bear the weaknesses of those without strength, and not just please ourselves. Each of us is to please his neighbor for his good, to his edification. For even Christ did not please himself, but as it is written, the reproaches of those who reproached you fell on me. For whatever was written in earlier times was written for our instruction, so that through perseverance and the encouragement of the scriptures, we might have hope. Now may the God who gives perseverance and encouragement grant you to be of the same mind with one another according to Christ Jesus, so that with one accord you may with one voice glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore accept one another just as Christ also accepted us to the glory of God. For I say that Christ has become a servant to the circumcision on behalf of the truth of God to confirm the promises given to the fathers and for the Gentiles to glorify God for his mercy, as it is written, therefore I will give praise to you among the Gentiles and I will sing to your name. Again, he says, rejoice, O Gentiles, with his people. And again, praise the Lord, all you Gentiles, and let all the peoples praise him. Again, Isaiah says, there shall come the root of Jesse, and he will arise to rule over the Gentiles. In him shall the Gentiles hope. Now may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that you will abound in hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. And may the Lord bless this reading of his word, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, cause it to bear fruit in our hearts. Let's pray. The Christian life is a miracle. I've said that before, and it's true. By the grace of God, we become a new creation. And the great evidence of the change is that people who are naturally selfish, and that's everyone, become selfless. We put the interests of others ahead of our own. And that's what Paul asks mature Christians to do in Romans 15. Really, what he's asking them to do is to live out the new life that they have. Put others first. Specifically, make sacrifices for weak Christians. He's been teaching on the relationship of the weak and the strong in chapter 14. A weak Christian is the one who has not yet fully understood his or her freedom in Christ. The problem isn't about morality or honesty, but morally indifferent things like diet and calendars, what a person can eat and or cannot eat, should a person keep the Sabbath or not. In our day, we speak of Christian taboos, forbidden things, forbidden practices that are determined by culture rather than the Bible. The weak feel an obligation to follow these rules. The strong don't. And there's the rub. In fact, the clash between the two groups can cause deep division in a church. And that's what Paul wanted to avoid. That's what he saw happening in the church of Rome. And so in Romans 15, he instructs the strong, the mature, to be patient with the weak. Seek to please them and not please self. Accept them. Don't alienate them. In fact, and this is the difficulty, really, serve them. Twice in our passage, he gives Christ as our example of all of this, first in regard to selflessness, and then secondly in regard to service. But the purpose here is to encourage unity so that their Christian witness will be clear and they will glorify God in it. Up to this point, Paul hasn't actually used the word strong. He does that now in verse 1 of chapter 15 and includes himself among them when he tells them to bear the weaknesses of those without strength. Now we who are strong ought to do that, ought to bear their weaknesses. Bear their weaknesses. That means be patient with them. Paul wasn't encouraging the strong to adopt the taboos or the attitudes of the weak, but to endure or tolerate the weak and not shun them, not put them aside, not alienate them. Many of those who were without strength would have been Jewish converts. We've discussed this in the past few weeks, who still felt the need to keep a kosher diet or to observe the Sabbath. And I think we need to remember to appreciate this. And it's probably difficult for us to do that in our milieu, in our society, and the way we have been conditioned culturally. But for the Jew, these people who had just come out of Judaism into Christianity, this was quite a challenge because they had grown up with these dietary laws. They'd grown up rigidly observing the Sabbath. There was no room for compromise and all of that. And suddenly, that is something they've been freed from. And so they found that difficult. And they observed these things, continue to do this as following their consciences. The strong, Paul is saying, were to accommodate them. They were not to please themselves. They were not to try to force their views on these believers, not to insist on practicing their liberties at the expense and to the offense of the weak. Now, that takes a willingness on the part of the mature to make a sacrifice, to be selfless, to put others first. Really, this has a specific issue that's being dealt with, and so we will stay within the bounds of that in our lesson. But you can see the principles here that apply broadly to how we relate to one another in not seeking our own interests ahead of others. And this is what he's counseling them to do, to put these weaker believers first, to be indulgent, as it were, to tolerate them and not try to force them. That's the Christian life. And to emphasize that, Paul repeats the instruction in verse 2, but he does so in a positive way. Each of us, he says, is to please his neighbor for his good, to his edification. In other words, endure this, tolerate these people, but don't just tolerate them, edify them. So in regard to the weak, pleasing them doesn't mean giving them control of the church. It doesn't mean that the strong acquiesce, that they give in to the weak's set of rules. That would be a compromise of grace, and really it would prevent the church from growing. Yielding to legalistic demands is destructive. It's not good. They need to be corrected, these weak individuals. They need to be taught. But that must be done wisely, and that must be done carefully. That's what Paul is saying. And that's clear from his last statement, in which good is defined as being to the person's edification. We are to be building people up, not tearing them down. It is constructive work. And it involves helping to educate them in order to strengthen their conscience so that they will grow out of their weakness. That takes patience. But we have a good example for doing it, and Paul gives us that in verses 3 and 4 with the example of Christ. He served us selflessly, and that should be incentive for us to do the same. For even Christ did not please himself, but as it is written, the reproaches of those who reproached you fell on me. even though he is the eternal Son of God, the maker of heaven and earth, the sustainer of all things, very God of very God, still he humbled himself to become a man and suffer for our salvation. Why shouldn't we please ourselves? The world tells us to do that. Look out for number one. That's one of the great laws of the world, what governs personal behavior. Look out for yourself. Well, we shouldn't do it because Christ didn't do it. And he is both our model and our motivation. Paul illustrates the Lord's selflessness from Psalm 69, which is a psalm of affliction. David is writing of his own experiences, but beyond David, what is really being written in that psalm is a prophecy of Christ himself. But he writes of his suffering. He writes of the insults David does of men and what was brought upon him because of his loyalty to the Lord, because of who he was. Because he was God's anointed, his chosen king, men persecuted him. Saul and his men pursued him relentlessly and tried to kill him. All of that because of who he was, chosen of the Lord and a man living in obedience to God. And this is what happened to Christ because of his faithfulness to his Father. He might have avoided it if he had chosen an easier path, but he didn't. He did the work God gave him to do, even unto death, even death on a cross. And it is there that we see him especially suffering the insults of men. Matthew records how the Roman soldiers put a scarlet robe on him and a crown of thorns and mocked him as Israel's king. As he hung on the cross, people passed by and hurled insults at him. The chief priests mocked him and said that if he was really the Son of God, then let him come down from the cross and demonstrate it. Now, he could have done that. He could have saved himself, but he had come to do God's will. And really, I should pause at that point to say, hypothetically, he could have done that. He had the power to come off the cross and with the spirit of his mouth slay everyone there. He could have done that, hypothetically, but not actually, because he is the Son of God. And as the Son of God, he could not do but the will of God. And it was God's will that he come and he suffer for his people. And so he did that. He did that willingly. He did that out of obedience to his Father. He did that to save us. And so he took the abuse. He took the abuse willingly. Well, since Christ refused to please himself, it follows, doesn't it, that we must do the same for the sake of obedience. Since he suffered abuse for our sake, the strong should be willing to give up wine or whatever for the sake of the weak when it might offend. Now, Paul makes that point from the Old Testament, but as he explains in the next verse, in verse 4, that doesn't make the point any less valid. We are not under the law. Paul has made that very clear in this book. In chapter 10 and verse 4, he made that very clear. It's all fulfilled in Jesus Christ. But still, citing the Old Testament is completely appropriate because whatever, Paul writes, was written in earlier times was written for our instruction. The Old Testament is Scripture. It's God's inerrant word. It teaches us about God's holiness. It gives us principles of conduct, and it gives us examples of them in the lives of Old Testament saints and in a variety of ways. I'm reading through the book of Leviticus. Actually, I just finished the book of Leviticus. I'm reading through the Bible. I hope the rest of you are doing the same. It's an important exercise that we should be engaged in. When you come to books like Leviticus and you wonder, what is this really about? I understand it's the laws that governed Israel, but how do we relate to this? Because these aren't laws that apply to us. You read about leprosy and how leprosy is to be treated. And you realize as you think about it, it's not really about health so much as other things, of ceremony and all. And the reality is it applies very directly to us, because while those were laws that governed Israel and they don't govern the church, they don't govern us, we're not under that law as a code of life. Nevertheless, it instructs us because it tells us about sin, which leprosy is a great illustration of, and how heinous that is, and how repugnant it is to us and to God, and how it is to be avoided because it is contagious. And you can see all of the various applications of that to us. The Old Testament instructs us in that way. Its law instructs us in that way about righteousness, about holiness, about being separated from that which is unclean and to be separated and wholly committed to God. And so these things are taught to us in the Old Testament in a variety of ways, the negative and the positive. We have the examples of the saints and how we should live from them, and the counsel that is given. And then, of course, the Old Testament, most importantly, teaches us about Christ and its types and pictures and prophecies. It's all about Him. The Lord said that. He said that in John chapter 5 and verse 39. It is these, He told the Jews, the Scriptures, that testify about Me. We will never understand the Old Testament. We will never understand the Bible unless we understand that it is about Christ. The law and the prophets and the Psalms are about Him. And so the Old Testament was written for our instruction as well as for the instruction of Israel and the Jews. And here Paul says it was designed to give us hope, the hope of eternal life and the perseverance and encouragement to hold on to that hope to the very end. Now, it does that in various ways. It gives promises of life and examples of God's faithfulness to those who trust in Him. You see that all through the Old Testament. David speaks here in the Psalms, in Psalm 69, of suffering for Christ and the persecution. But you see, as you read through the life of David and you read through the Psalms in which he pours out his heart to God, how God is faithful to him and watches over him and takes care of him. And that's a lesson for us. It teaches us in that way that we can trust in Him. Reading its prophecies and seeing how they are fulfilled in Christ and how they apply to the church gives hope, gives encouragement. Encouragement to persevere, continue on. Verse 5, Paul writes that God gives perseverance and encouragement. That's what the Bible gives us, so that's one means of obtaining that. But here he's saying God gives that. So taken together, God gives it, the Scriptures give it. We put those together, it's God gives that to us through His Scripture, through the Bible. He is our counselor. And He supplies us with strength as we look to Him in His Word and in prayer. Now think about that. What greater counselor can we have than that? What greater counselor can we have than the Lord God, the Lord Jesus Christ, who speaks to us through His Word? In Psalm 119 and verse 24, which is a psalm about the Word of God, it is a psalm in which the psalmist elevates and rejoices in and gives praise to the Bible, to Scripture, because it is the words from God's mouth, as he puts it. It comes from Him. It is the mind of God. And so he praises that. But in verse 24, he speaks of God's testimonies, and he calls them His counselors. What he's saying there is, my best counselors are right here in this book. My best friends are here in the Bible. It's Moses, it's David, it's the psalmists, it's the prophets. And as I study them and read them, they encourage me, they counsel me, they direct me. Dr. Johnson made that point very well. He said that when we have difficulty, the first thing we do is flee to our counselors, amateur or professionals. And he said, but they can never do the work of the Word of God. I'm not saying there's not a place for professional counselors, but I think his point is well taken. That's not the first place we flee. We flee to the Word of God. It's through the Scriptures that we have the Lord Jesus Christ as our constant companion and permanent moment-by-moment counselor. Christ, through the Holy Spirit, is our comforter and our guide. And that's the one to whom we should run. We need to know the Bible, in other words. Old Testament and New Testament, all 66 books of the Bible. It is God's inerrant word. It was written for our instruction, Paul says. It gives wisdom to those who study it. It gives hope and strength. It gives us perseverance, which is essential for unity. Well, how is that? How is hope essential for unity? Well, hope is a great incentive to sacrifice for others, to serve others, to please them and not please ourselves. Because when we understand the hope we have, we know that whatever we do and whatever sacrifice we may make in this life is of eternal value. It counts for the future. It counts forever. The reason the world fights for survival, the reason the world does whatever it can to get the upper hand and a personal advantage is because it has no hope, no real hope, no hope of an eternal future. This life is all there is as far as the world can see. You only go around once. You have to grab for all that you can get. We are different. We don't live like the world. The Bible and the knowledge of it gives us hope, real hope, which is a great blessing. It encourages sacrifice and facilitates unity among us. But that's not the only way we gain this hope and we gain this endurance and all that Paul is speaking of here. Prayer is also a means of great blessing. It's the means of laying hold of the promises that we read about, that we study about in God's Word, a means of gaining the wisdom that is there in the Bible for us. And in verses 5 and 6, Paul prays for the church in Rome. He prays that the God who gives perseverance and encouragement would give them unity, that they would be of the same mind with one another according to Christ. God's the source of these blessings. He gives endurance and encouragement. We should strive for them. We're responsible to do that, to make effort, to understand the Bible and to live obediently to it. But it is God who gives them, who gives all these virtues to us. So we're to pray for them. Paul was concerned that they be of the same mind, that they think in the same way. Now, he doesn't mean by that they have all the same opinions, but that they be in harmony with one another. Paul has instructed them to be accepting of one another in spite of their differences. So it's not a prayer that they stop having differences of opinion, but that they be at peace with one another with those differences. In other words, don't let the differences divide us, is what he's saying. That will happen, that is, this unity will happen as they stop trying to please themselves and instead please their neighbor, put the other person first. And so Paul was indirectly praying that God would create that disposition within them. But unity is not an end in itself. Paul gives the purpose of it in verse 6, and that is to glorify God. And that, of course, is the purpose of everything. Paul's made that point clear at the end of chapter 11, but this is the point that he makes here. It's all to glorify God. He wants them to glorify God with one mind and one mouth. God is not honored when the church is a house divided. Now, of course, to do that, to honor him, to glorify him, there must be unity of opinion or unity of doctrine in the essentials before there can be harmony that is of any value at all. Now, Paul indicates that in verse 5, he spoke of unity according to Christ. Here in verse 6, he wants us to have the same voice about God the Father and Jesus Christ. So Paul's prayer assumes that they are united in the essential doctrines of the faith, that they are all believers in Jesus Christ, that they understand that he is the eternal Son of God who became a man and offered himself up on the cross, and that there is salvation in no other name but that name. That's assumed here. Unity would be meaningless otherwise. Agreement in error is worthless. They were united in their knowledge of God and their faith in Christ, but the problems in the church, the friction between the weak and the strong, kept them from speaking with one voice. So in order to praise God rightly, it was necessary that the church be unified. To achieve that, Paul urges them in verse 7 to accept one another. He made the same appeal the very beginning of this rather lengthy discussion on the weak and the strong back in verse 1 of chapter 14. And now he makes it in verse 7 of chapter 15. John Stott wrote that Paul's long argument about the strong and the weak is sandwiched between two cries: accept him and accept one another. Accept him in chapter 14, verse 1. Accept one another here in chapter 15, verse 7. The whole church was to welcome its members into fellowship. Accept one another as equal in Christ and as brothers and sisters in Christ in spite of all their differences which they had. We're always going to have differences of all kinds. We're to accept one another. And Paul gives a theological or moral basis for doing that, and it is what Christ did. Accept one another just as Christ also accepted us. So again, Christ is the great illustration here. Christ is our example. He accepted sinners on the basis of grace. Grace alone. Not on the basis of anything within us, but on the basis of grace. And we are to accept one another in the same way, freely and gladly and unconditionally. Christ did that to the glory of God. All the credit for the welcome we have, each one of us, into God's family goes to God alone, who took the initiative through Christ to save us and make us acceptable to him, make us righteous in his sight. We can take no credit for that, but we can do the same in regard to one another in our behavior. And in that way, we also bring glory to God by manifesting his grace in the change that he has produced within us and that's seen in our behavior. The world pleases itself first, but putting others first, by doing that, we show that we are different from the world. We demonstrate the nature of God's love, and we demonstrate his power to transform sinners into saints and make us completely different from the world. I saw a program on PBS, I think it was. It reminded me of the 60s and the Democrat convention and how the revolutionaries, which they really were crying out, "The whole world is watching." Well, they meant one thing by that, but there's some truth of that for us. The world is watching us, and they see what we're, if our confession matches our conduct. And this is a great example of God's witness to the world in our behavior and the way we treat one another. The unity of believers brings great glory to God, and so we are to follow Christ's example and accept one another. That's a command. Paul gives further support to it in the remaining verses with another example of Christ who not only united the weak and the strong, but also Jews and Gentiles. That particular ministry of Christ shows the need to overcome a fundamental problem of human nature and a problem in the churches. It's the problem of bias. It's the problem of partiality. It's the problem of party spirit. And that was particularly acute in the first century and evidently in the Church of Rome, because in the first century there was a great divide between the Jew and the Gentile, between the Romans and the Hebrews. They didn't like each other. The Jews called the Gentiles dogs, and the Gentiles despised the Jews for their separation from everything that they did. And so there was this animosity between them. Christ is the Savior of the world. He didn't save just one tribe or nation or ethnic group. He loves every kind of people, and His people are to love them as well. He has made both Jews and Gentiles full members of God's people, and they are to receive one another as full members, and they are to live in harmony and in fellowship with one another. Paul writes that Christ became a servant of the circumcision, meaning He became a servant of the Jews. He became the Jewish Messiah, and He had two purposes in doing that. First, to confirm the promises given to the fathers, to fulfill the prophecies and promises made to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. In other words, to prove that God is true and His word is reliable. That glorifies God. The second purpose is given in verse 9, and it was to make the Gentiles part of God's people and give them a share in those promises that were given to Israel. Paul says Christ's ministry to the Jews was because of the truth of God. That is, it was for the purpose, as I said, of demonstrating God's faithfulness to His covenant, His agreement, His promise, and prophecies to the people. His ministry to the Gentiles, he says, was because of His mercy. God had made covenants with the Jews, but He didn't make any special covenant with the Gentiles. In Ephesians chapter 2, Paul speaks of them as the uncircumcision, who were excluded from the commonwealth of Israel and strangers to the covenants of promise, having no hope. That's the Gentile. Throughout the Old Testament, there were promises of Gentile salvation. God promised Abraham at the very beginning that through him, and ultimately through Christ, Abraham's descendant, the nations would be blessed. But God made no covenant with the Gentiles like the ones that He made with Israel. As Paul said, they were without hope. And so Christ's reception of Gentiles demonstrates most clearly His love and His care for them, for the weak and the undeserving. Paul proves all of this by giving four quotations from the Old Testament, from 2 Samuel 22, verse 15, from Deuteronomy 32, verse 43, from Psalm 117, verse 1, and finally from Isaiah 11, verse 10, which is a wide spectrum of Old Testament texts, which shows the breadth of this promise that was given. But we begin in verse 9. Therefore, I will give praise to you among the Gentiles, and I will sing to your name. Again, he says, rejoice, O Gentiles, with His people. And again, praise the Lord, all you Gentiles, and let all the peoples praise Him. Again, Isaiah says, there shall come the root of Jesse, and he who arises to rule over the Gentiles. In him shall the Gentiles hope. Well, that is, as I said, a wide sampling of Scripture that predicted the coming of the Messiah as the Savior of the Jews and of the Gentiles. It's from the law, it's from the writings, which are the historical books, it's from the Psalms and the prophets. The last quotation in verse 12 from Isaiah prophesied that the Messiah would be at the same time the root of Jesse and the hope of the nations, a blessing to both Jews and Gentiles. But all four quotes from the Old Testament clearly state and emphasize Gentile salvation. Christ came to save the Jews in faithfulness to His promises, but in His mercy He also saved Gentiles. And in doing that, he united the two groups into one. We are united. The dividing wall has been broken down, Paul says in Ephesians. The two have been made one. That's the reality, so we need to live according to it, really is what he's saying. He wanted both to understand this so that the weak and the strong, the Jews and the Gentiles in the church at Rome would be accepting of one another, would be united, not dividing with each other, to the glory of God. Paul then concludes his discussion on debatable things with a prayer. In fact, his prayer in verse 13 effectively ends the book of Romans. The rest of the book is taken up with personal matters, but Paul's prayer here ends this discussion on the weak and the strong, and it's a prayer for hope. He prays to the God of hope. Paul's already stated in verse 4 that the scriptures promise hope. As we know them, as we know the scriptures, our hope increases. But prayer is also a means of increasing it. It's a means of gaining. The scriptures, as we read them, are the means of learning and gaining the promises, all the virtues and encouragements that Paul gives here. But also, as I said earlier, prayer is the means of obtaining them as well. And here Paul prays for hope, that it would take root in their hearts. Now hope, as you know, looks to the future. We don't hope for the past, we hope for things in the future. And since Paul has just quoted Isaiah 11 and verse 10, a prophecy about the Messiah and his future reign on the earth, the hope that Paul is referring to here is the hope of the glorious future that we have. It's what Paul explained back in chapter 11. When he wrote about the fullness of the Gentiles coming in and the salvation of all Israel occurring. That is when history will conclude with Christ's coming and kingdom and then the eternal state of a glorious new universe. That is our hope. That hope goes back to the prophets. It goes back to Isaiah chapter 2 when he said that men will hammer their swords into plowshares and never again learn war. It's not happened. Never happened. There's never been a day of peace in this world. That's our future. And because God is the sovereign governor of history who is guiding all events to that certain conclusion, Paul addresses him as the God of hope. He's the object of hope because he is the one who has promised us this glorious future, but he is the source of hope because he's the one who creates hope in our hearts, and it will happen. What we hope for will occur. That is the concern of Paul's prayer, that the Romans, that we, that God's people abound in hope. But first Paul prays that God would fill them with joy and peace. The peace Paul prays for is inner peace. It's not peace with God. They have that. They've been justified. They've been reconciled to God. So peace here that he speaks of isn't peace with God, but the peace of God. The Lord wants that for us. He wants us to be at peace in this world and not to be anxious about all of the uncertainties of life. And if we read the paper, we watch the news, it's very difficult not to be concerned and anxious about the situation in which we live. It's always that way. It doesn't want us to be that way. It doesn't want us to be an anxious people. We are to be at peace and we are to have hope. He wants us to have joy. The two go together, peace and joy. We should not be a dreary, fearful people. What a testimony it is not to be that in this world. But these blessings come from God through faith. Faith, believing, is the channel through which we receive them. That's the connection that Paul makes. It is joy and peace in believing, because as we trust in the Lord, as we believe his word and obey it, as we do it, all of this, peace and joy, will increase within us. The Old Testament that Paul says was written for our instruction teaches that. In Isaiah chapter 26 and verse 3, I like the King James Version here. Thou wilt keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on thee because he trusteth in thee. The more we trust in the Lord, the more joy and peace we have, which increases our faith so that we will abound in hope, which again is the goal of Paul's prayer. Now may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing so that you will abound in hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. And ultimately that's where it comes from, the power of the Holy Spirit. It's how Paul concludes this section of the book, and really, as I said, effectively concludes the book of Romans. His prayer begins and ends with God as the source of our blessings and hope. And so we're to look to him, not look to other counselors, not look to other things, not fill our lives with all kinds of issues that really just detract and distract us. We're to look to him for blessing. And the promise is he will give blessing. He will give peace and joy and hope. And as we have hope and live for it, we will have unity among ourselves. I don't see a great problem of disunity in our church, but the possibility is always there, and we always need to be growing closer together, and we've got a fellowship coming up where we can do that, and we should spend time with one another. But as we think on these things and have this hope, then, of course, the weak and the strong come together, and then our witness will not only be with one voice, but it will be with force as the world observes us. The Puritan pastor, Richard Baxter, gave good counsel for the life of the church when he said, "In essentials, unity; in non-essentials, liberty; in all things, charity." That is good counsel. Following it gives glory to God. It is evidence of a changed life. And that is what God gives by his grace, the miracle of a new life. Do you have it? It's found in Jesus Christ alone, and it is for all who believe in him. He is the Savior of the world who died for sinners so that all who believe in him will be saved at that very moment of faith. So turn from indifference if you've never believed in him, or turn from all of your attempts to, by your own deeds, gain his approval and his acceptance by your good works. Simply trust in him. That's what it is. Believe in Jesus Christ. May God help you to do that and bless all of us with a desire to put one another first. Better that I bring it up than I go down to it. So, no, thank you, Marilyn, and Stephen, and Peeler, and Elizabeth, and James. That was a lively piece, wasn't it? I enjoyed that, but now I feel like I got to step up my pace a bit, so which isn't a bad thing.